Boom, and welcome back to this, another episode of the Happy No Fear podcast. I'm your host, Chase. And on this week's episode, we are recording from Barcelona, where I'm visiting an artist that has been really, really active in the local graffiti scene here, but also worldwide as an artist. His roots are in Argentina, but at the age of 11, he moved to Barcelona and immersed himself in all the good stuff that happened in the early 90s and became a very active participant. If you've been to Barcelona, you've seen his work. That's just the way it is. And yeah, it's popping. It's super happy. It's got that colorful flavor that I love. And yeah. Here he is. Without further ado, I give to you Zosen. So, yeah, no editing at all. At all.
Okay.
At all. So, roll. Take action. So, this is your first podcast you're doing.
First podcast, yes.
Yeah.
Not first interview, but first podcast.
Podcast,
but
yeah.
What is the difference? No, when you're doing a radio, it's different than this.
See, the thing, a podcast is long form, right? So
okay.
It's just, usually it's just two people talking. And most of the time, there's no questions prepared. There's just, you know,
more.
The host is interested in the person. Usually it's already a friend or someone they respect.
Okay.
And there's a respect there, and we just talk about things, and
okay.
And it's long form, which is interesting because then you can feel the person a little bit more. When it's very short, like okay, we have 7 minutes to do,
you
know,
you don't have enough time yet to develop things.
Exactly, and it's very pressured, you know.
Yeah.
So what's interesting about podcasts is because you just mentioned Robert De Niro did one,
yeah,
with Michael Moore.
Because I like the stuff they do, no? Like,
yeah.
You know, Michael Moore is more politic and Robert De Niro is like a classic actor and a New Yorker.
Yeah.
And I was thinking it was interesting the combination. And also Michael Moore said in his Instagram that was the first podcast by Robert De Niro.
That's amazing, man. It's really interesting because I was listening. I started. You know this artist, David Cho.
Yeah.
So
I met him here with Saber.
Oh wow! I remember that.
What a couple!
10 years ago or something, they were here. Yeah.
Maybe more.
It was nuts. They hit the street, huh?
And also the people.
Yeah.
Saber. Yeah.
What? Saber got aggressive.
We were in a bar and there was some misunderstood, I think, like a lost in translation, something with a girl outside the bar, but we were drinking absinthe.
Ah, absinthe.
And then they start a battle outside of the bar.
Okay.
And then Saber went out like, I want to stop this, but he
involved
became involved in and he broke like a bottle in a head of a
Jesus
guy.
Christ,
but in the bar, in this classic bar, is like close to the port. They are like the old bars with absinthe and leche de pantera, like panthers, of these weird drinks. They have like a parrot inside of a cage. And then start like, now we're there. And I remember that David Cho gave me like $20 to say, okay, pay, and we run. I said, man, this is Europe. This is not dollars. And we went to another bar and they were chilling.
David Cho, like I met him once for like a second, but for some reason I never really crossed paths too much.
Okay.
But he had a podcast called DVD ASA, which was called Double Vag, Double Anal Sensitive Artist. Okay. And he did it with the porn star Asa Akira. And it was unbelievable. It just sitting around and then more people joined. I think they did something like a couple of hundred episodes. But it was that guy is unbelievable. I really like that.
Yeah, you have good ideas. No?
Yeah,
so
just so pure, so open.
A TV program, something, no?
He's now he has, yeah. Yeah.
He's blonde or something.
Yeah,
I don't know if it's a wig
he's bananas, right?
Yeah.
You know what happened with him with the Facebook thing?
Yeah.
So imagine that, man. He's the highest paid.
He didn't know, no? And he was.
Of course he didn't know.
Living in the valley or close to this technological, yeah, no, business that you never know.
$300 million.
You don't care, no?
No, at this point, imagine you have $300 million. You, yeah, do what he does. You do the same.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
You know, you just do, travel, take He's all traveling. Your friends, you paint like crazy. You buy a big warehouse.
But when I met him, he was also, oh no, he used to write for Hustler magazine.
Okay,
he was involved with the, right, or, the, yeah, erotic stuff.
Yeah.
And I think, yeah, I, yeah, think he have, he started painting now in the,
right,
garage of his parents. But
yeah, yeah, yeah,
he have many interesting, you know, things.
Yeah.
I mean, like most of the people, not most of the people, but the artists when you grow up.
Yeah,
I mean, I still love graffiti, but I do also other stuff.
Yeah, I just saw, I was just scrolling down your Instagram, just, you know, to see all the latest stuff and everything. And I saw you posted a train from 1995.
Yeah,
nice. Zosen,
yeah,
Bandido.
Yeah, sometimes I post to, yeah, to, because I have another name to do the illegal stuff, graffiti stuff.
You still do today?
Yeah,
you,
yeah,
sometimes,
yeah,
still go out. And,
yeah, with Kenor. Kenor is a good friend, and,
yeah,
we connect really well because we are with the, from the same generation. We grow with the same styles, no? Growing with the, no, hip hop music,
yeah,
after,
yeah, yeah, yeah,
electronic, raves, whatever, drugs. And he's 2 years older than me, but it's, I think, our connection to the youth years,
right,
no, to the teenage years, to. You go to do a mission, no? Even,
yeah,
if,
yeah,
you are 40s or something, we still have this song, this magic, because most of the people, I think, when they became adults, they are more stupid in a,
yeah,
way, because they lost this,
the childhood playfulness, yeah.
Yeah, the child you have inside. And then when we go with the bikes to the track sides or to do a mission in the highway or something, you develop this adrenaline and,
yeah,
these things that it connect instantly with the, when you were a teenager.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. That's it's like that. Yeah.
It's
fun, good, and you can keep that alive. You know, you can keep sharing that.
Yeah, yeah.
But,
yeah,
then, you know,
we say this is the pill of the youth. You know,
the pill of the youth.
Yeah. With this, we go back to the 90s.
Yeah, yeah,
you know,
yeah.
And also we use it to listen to hardcore rap, like Britcore rap, like these bands from the beginning of the 90s: Hayak, Silver Bullet, Gunshot, whatever. And
Hijacks,
yeah,
the terrorist crew.
Yeah, yeah. And with
I
this,
remember that, man.
Yeah, yeah. But this music
is pumped up. Yeah,
yeah, yeah.
I think I have that single somewhere.
Yeah, this, right, is gold, man.
So you pump that in the ears and,
yeah,
bam,
and
you go.
And you say, okay, man, we need to go to bomb with, yeah, this music. Yeah, the terrorist group. Yeah, yeah.
Man, that's amazing. I haven't thought of that
but
in maybe
I mean,
20 years.
But also, we are in the new things.
Right,
we,
of course.
We go, I mean, we are not just in the romanticism of the when we were young, no, because we,
yeah,
are others, but we still connected,
yeah,
with the new stuff.
Yeah, it's crazy how music, like sometimes I needed to listen to certain albums or certain songs from back then,
yeah,
when I was just discovering everything.
Yeah.
When maybe I did my first wall or something, or,
yeah,
things were starting.
Reminds you,
yeah. Anything, and you're way back there, and I could almost feel it in my mind, the feeling, the smell of how I felt back then. It's weird, huh?
It's interesting. This,
yeah.
I don't know with the new generations if they will have this thing. I think no. Like to discover.
It's hard to say.
Yeah, today I was speaking with Min about this because I buy a record and stuff. Like, oh, this record reminds me when I started listening to this group or this album or learning English because I'm self-taught. I,
yeah,
didn't went to
Your English is good.
I mean, traveling and,
yeah,
listen to music and,
yeah,
English music and then. You learn, no?
Yeah.
Because when we were, teenagers, we didn't know that much English.
Yeah, because I think what the problem is, and this is the problem. Why in Italy, France, and,
yeah,
Spain,
they do the translation.
Yeah, no, yeah, in the movies, it's some other guy. Iniesta momento, and then the mouth does something else.
Yeah.
Right.
I mean, you can imagine
in the movies,
Robert De Niro speaking in Catalan,
yeah,
or even Arnold Schwarzenegger in Terminator.
I posted it last night. And also in Germany, same thing. You like Klein Bitchen Frühstück, and it's Brad Pitt saying that. I'm like, it's hilarious.
You lose like the interpretation.
Yeah, and you can't learn because, like in Belgium, let's say, or in Holland, we have subtitle, right? So we hear it in English, and then we read it in our language, which is sort of like a school, you know.
I think this
it's
is
a,
good.
Class, yeah.
I remember first time I was in Copenhagen in Denmark. My friends they were watching like. The Simpsons, and they were, yeah, with the
subtitle, yeah,
Danish subtitle.
It's helpful, I think, because you don't know that you're learning, but I think it's very, very helpful.
But here, I think it's like a heritage of the dictatorship of Franco and Italy, most of the same of Mussolini and all the patriotism that people, they don't want to learn, or they are lazy because, come on, you can read, then you can watch a movie with a subtitle.
Yeah. It should be. And also, I don't like that because let's say, how would it be in our world? It's like, your painting is showing, let's say, in Japan, let's say, right? And your work, right, is all of a sudden they put a filter on it. Like, hey, wait a minute. No. So, you know, here...
It's not 100% real.
But it's not real. You know, people have never heard Al Pacino's voice in Spain.
Yeah.
Right? They've never heard it.
Just the translator.
Yeah, I know. It's very funny. So, because an actor, the voice he speaks is very
it's part
very
of the act.
Hi. We have a guest in the studio. Right. You can speak. It's totally fine. It's relaxed. Yeah.
You're
part of it. Mina walked in.
Yeah, Mina used to listen to podcasts more than me. Yeah.
It's a fun thing, huh? Yeah. Oh, yeah, that was the first one. Yeah. You got to listen to the other ones.
Yeah.
They get better. But Carlos, I love, and she was really good.
Also, we were together last December in Miami, and we were sharing like a wall, and we were spending some time together.
She's good, huh?
Yeah, she's a big heart, and so smart.
Yeah.
And I understand why she's traveling and being nomadic.
She's living it.
Yeah.
She has the energy.
No, and to learn and to share, you know?
Yeah. Absorb like sponge. Mm. Yeah.
But it's crazy that she grew up in Belgium, right? And also, she went to the same school of Topo.
Yeah.
But they didn't speak each other in the school. They met after.
Ah, I didn't know that.
Yeah.
No way.
Now you know.
Now I know.
They were doing graphic design the same school.
Yeah. Unbelievable.
Crazy.
That is really... Yeah, she lived in a small city right outside of Ghent. And you've been to Ghent many times.
Yeah, because friend with...
With Bue.
Bue, Resto, Roa.
Roa, yeah.
Yeah, all this. With Topo, I met because Bue and Resto. Yeah. And also in Antwerp, I did an exhibition with Remed.
With Remed?
Yeah.
Shouts to Remed, yeah.
Yeah, Remed. Shout outs. Yeah, it was like 12 years ago,
no
16
shit.
Years ago. Fefe came, also Fefe Talavera,
Fefe,
she came.
Also killer.
Was in a small gallery, 85 gallery, I think. Well, it was a small gallery, but we did a collective show and it was good. We were also doing breakdance.
Nice.
And because we have also friends from Brussels.
Yeah.
And it's not that far. I mean, Belgium is small. And they came and was like a jam. Yeah,
really,
I mean, like a breakdancing. We went to the radio and we rapped. In French, Portuguese, Spanish, also good.
I mean, just having fun.
Antwerp is cool.
I dig it. 12 years ago, I was still unable to travel. I was a little bit stuck in the States for a while. And so I started coming again, maybe like 10, 11 years ago. So, I missed that one. But Barcelona. We're here, man.
This is Barcelona.
It looks like the shutters are good to paint again.
Yeah, because the council, they don't buff it because they are private.
Good.
But yeah, mostly for bombers. I don't like the format because it's square and it's kind of small for me. When I do letters, I paint big.
Yeah.
Then I prefer...
But I'm happy, because last time I was here was 10 years ago. And
people, they were buffing everything. Yeah,
and they said, don't paint shutters because you're going to get tickets on the spot. And they said it was going to be 120 euro or something like this. Yeah.
Yeah. Now it's more relaxed.
Yeah.
But there are more people also painting.
It's unbelievable. Yeah. But there's good stuff. I was walking around last night. There's some really nice shutters now, man. Wow. People are really taking the time to make something nice.
They are like a lot of bombers doing shutters and also people doing decorations for the show.
Yeah, because at one point it was like your crew a little bit, you, Keno, Pez, like owning Barcelona, no?
Well, I mean, not only, but for a while.
Like,
I think
in this
pass through graffiti to the beginning of this thing of street art or post graffiti or something, we were there, and other people doing graffiti, they were doing the same of forever.
Yeah.
And then I think was the moment that people started to see that they were something different on the walls, and we were there, no, painting,
yeah.
And also we were doing collage and another styles and mixing with acrylic,
yeah,
and textures, paper, and the other people, they were doing just regular classic graffiti.
Yeah.
And I think was the moment, and all the people, they came to live here, no, like,
yeah,
me and Miss Van and other friends,
yeah,
and they were organizing the English people, like, meeting called like Finders Keepers, and we met
Finders Keepers, yeah.
Finders Keepers,
yeah.
We met Chad from the police,
yeah,
Gallo,
yeah, yeah,
all,
yeah,
the guys, Pine Fortress, the Chim,
yeah,
all,
yeah,
the good,
yeah,
guys.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Plus, like, the Italians, Microbo, and all the people,
yeah,
from,
yeah,
Milan.
These are all the people a little bit our age or slightly older,
yes,
a little bit younger, right?
I think
that was the original movement, kind
we,
of.
We
right?
can say this kind of the foundation of,
yeah,
the street,
sure,
art or post graffiti,
yeah, 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 for sure. Like, Barcelona was heaven to come, you know, and the scene was very much alive. Amsterdam had it too for a second,
yeah,
but not as much. But then they
because,
also shut
because,
everything
because
down
because architecture is not able to do the things like here. We,
yeah,
have a lot of factories and
right,
all buildings in Amsterdam. Is well located, but the architecture is not really,
yeah,
friendly to,
yeah,
do a
it's
lot
protected
of
and everything, yeah.
But we were bombing, yeah, a lot. I remember we did an interrail, yeah, and in Amsterdam we met also again Chaz and Microbo,
yeah,
and we were doing paste ups and,
yeah,
painting.
This is, we're talking like 2003
was this.
Yeah,
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 exactly. Yeah.
And I remember that at this time still bombed Amsterdam.
Yeah,
but after they start to buff.
Yeah, everything protected, blah, blah, blah. And then maybe Berlin popped up, Kreuzberg,
true,
and everything was a good place also. And then, yeah, it's interesting. It seems like it was yesterday,
yeah,
but it's already 17 years ago, man.
Yeah, it's true. It's true. I have good memories. I mean, we're still in contact, yeah, of course, with some of them. Yeah, with Chaz, we see
he's
him
hilarious,
around.
Man.
Yeah,
funny. So hilarious.
If he, you find,
yeah,
him, you have party.
You have good time.
Or you have some shots of tequila.
I did a show with Chaz, London Police, but some at this one gallery, Oscar. What's his name?
Go Gallery,
yeah.
She did a show on,
yeah,
Sabina, all the women.
Yeah.
Woman show.
Excellent. He just emailed me out of the blue a couple of days ago because they're going to do an anniversary of that show, which was...
But they started like the 20 years ago.
I know. And they really helped London Police, right?
Yeah. They're still working, I,
yeah,
think, together. Yeah.
So we did this show. It was, who was it? Bue, me, London Police, Fortress, Gallo. Gallo was in there. Yeah, of course he was in there. And
we did an exhibition in his gallery in Turin.
Me too.
In Torino.
I did a two-man show with Bue. I was there 2 weeks.
Oh,
but
eating good, right?
Not eating good.
No?
No, I was surprised.
No?
But you
weren't going out.
We were going out nice
with Gallo.
But, I mean, we were eating a lot, but I can't say sorry, Gallo, if you're listening. You know, I love you, but I didn't really eat good Italian food.
But the week we were there, we spent a lot of money, of course, but also party. It was our party time. The triangle, this place.
Skin it. Roll that spliff, spliff it up. He loves to spliff it.
Oh, man.
That wall has been painted a million times in the gallery.
Yeah, yeah.
If you can peel back.
We painted as well, the wall in the gallery.
Yeah, yeah. That's quite incredible.
Yeah.
So we were there, and this is the funny thing.
Crossing paths. Yeah.
So we're doing that in Amsterdam, and because Chaz is hilarious, but all of a sudden, Fortress had some truffles, you know, a mushroom truffle. And he gave to everyone, we eat the mushroom
truffles.
For
the opening?
No, after.
After.
Yeah, not for the opening. Or maybe he was, I don't know. But in any case, I laughed. I never laughed so hard in my life.
But after you were like walking through the streets?
We were just at a bar.
In front of
And for some reason, across the street, we were all at this bar. The truffles get spread around. 20 minutes later, we're like feeling really good. Everything, your body orgasm, your mind starts tingling. And for some reason, everything he said, he already had the mullet and a little bit the mustache, you know, with the little beer belly. And he starts commenting on, there's a door across the street, a red door with a light on it. And then, for some reason, that door became so funny to us. We were like laughing. Like
about the red door.
Yeah, like rolling in the street, like dying. And then all of a sudden, right when we're like sort of stopped with the laughing, someone came out of the door and tripped. So we're destroyed. You
crazy
know?
People. No?
So funny. So I think Fortress is even funnier if you catch him at the right time.
We did the last time.
So funny. Man.
We saw each other. Yeah, with each one we have some chapters. We can do the movie. Yeah, or the. So we can funny. Do now. Yeah, a program for Netflix or something about all these. I mean, the past, present, and future.
Yes.
No? We did. I remember good memories in Lisbon, in Portugal, with the fortress.
Also, nice place.
We did a collective show in the Montana and the old Montana shop gallery from Lisbon, with some people from Switzerland. They print some screen prints, whatever. And we were there, and of course, we were drinking a lot with Fortress. And after dinner one night, the night of the opening, I don't remember what it was that night, but they were the younger graffiti writers, the race crew from Lisbon. They said, you want to paint a train? Yeah. Let's go. And we did a back jump in the Caixa Sodré, like in the main station in Lisbon, drunk, the belly full of food and with Fortress. And we did, we got down. It was a good time.
Quick 20 minutes in and out.
Less. Yeah. I mean, but it's like new generation that they paint the... You have somebody outside or in the yard checking for the security guard, because it was security in the yard, with the telephone, with the cell phone.
And they
were saying, okay, now you need to go down. Okay, hide. It's coming, the people cleaning. Okay, go fast.
Wow,
it was like really...
So people there, doesn't matter, you go anyway. And zigzag, frog or video game.
But it was a lot of stress, because in this station you have like three different... transportation. You have like the boat to go to the other island. I mean, in front, Almeda, I can't remember the place. The train and the train and the other thing is another commuter, you know.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And then we are kind of subway, and we need to jump. Whatever.
And then belly is full. You know, someone has to go.
But also drunk. But we were like, we are old, but we can do it, and we did it. Yeah. And after, we were like younger. To train spotters, we went to the station next day to wait for our train to take the photo.
So much fun, man.
Yeah, so much fun. Fortress is good person and good artist. I really
fantastic.
Respect him.
I love his
stuff. We have a lot of skills. We were in the north of Holland last summer in a city called Leeuwarden. And we saw a big mural from him. Really
He's
good.
Amazing.
He can do whatever he wants.
Unbelievable. Full control.
Yeah.
Wow.
Also the graphic design and everything.
Just all the right decisions all the time. Like I really want to get inspired, you know, I just go to...
you check his stuff.
Yeah, that's it. I just look, you know, like, oh, that's a good decision. That halftone. And then when he did a Trooper recently where there was a thickness of the line, you know, goes from thick to thin to thick. The latest one he posted just now with the little bat ears.
Okay.
Right? And just like the decisions, you know? So rich. I love.
You need to do the podcast, with all these characters. Yeah. I think it will be a good collection.
Of course. I'm trying to make a good collection of people that I like, you know?
Yeah.
And so that's why we're here. And, you know, we never met before this.
Yeah.
But I've been so aware of your stuff. I really dig it. I really love it.
Thank you.
And, you know, like Barcelona always, there was always happy feeling coming from Barcelona.
Yeah, because we have good weather. Not like in Belgium, but sorry. Yeah.
And I connected with that because my mission is a little bit the same. I just want to make a happy feeling, happy color, you know, give a good mood, you know.
Yeah.
And so I.
So
I
you decide to go to LA, not to have good weather.
In a way, yeah. I went for skateboarding, but then I saw. I mean, the weather is like Barcelona, maybe
similar.
The same. Yeah.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And so it's really inspiring, the sun. You know.
Yeah.
Like no sunshine is like, you know, and no sunshine and too much weed.
Maybe
like,
also Bue decide to go to Mexico because the weather and culture,
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Yeah.
Because I think, I mean, in Belgium, there are good artists, but the weather is shit. You know?
The weather is so bad, man. I just came from there, and it's now a soft winter, so it was not even raining. And I'm like, what's wrong in Belgium? It's not raining. It's normally always raining.
It's the global warming. But we did an exhibition, like a print exhibition 2012 in Brussels. Was not raining, but the strange thing that was like really hot.
Too hot is also not good.
Yeah, it was not good.
When you're sweating?
And then the people, they didn't come to the opening because it was not normal.
Oh, man.
So you're
fucked either way sometimes.
Well, it was just a pop-up one day, but Jerome and the Hello Monsters, Antoine, they came and all the friends.
Yeah, because when you're standing, when you're just walking and it's so humid that you're sweating, that's also not nice.
Yeah.
Like sometimes Miami, you know, that kind of vibe, it's like... It's heavy, man.
But the LA is similar than Miami with the air conditioner. I mean, it's everywhere.
Oh, that's true. Yeah. Air conditioner is everywhere.
But it was not a cultural shock for you. I mean, coming from Belgium to go there and people is going out the house and they put it on. I mean, you don't think about the...
It was a culture shock a little bit. Like, I lived there with my parents from 9 to 11. So was it in the 80s, you know? And so I got my first skateboard in Venice Beach.
Whoa.
Back to the Future came out.
Suicidal tendencies.
Whoa. So I was living in LA as a little kid.
Wow, man.
You know, feeling that vibe, that power of American Hollywood and products and Nike and skateboarding, music, everything. So I always knew maybe I was going to try to come back.
These years, I think they are important. No, when
very,
you are 9, 10, 11, you are becoming from child to teenager and you are developing taste, no, in things.
Taste, yeah.
And you were there and you were in love.
And I was like, wow,
this
is something. But I was still a little bit too young to really understand, but I remember the feeling. And then, you know, got the skateboard in Venice Beach. Then my dad's plans didn't work out. And we had to go back to Belgium after 2 years, but I was now a skateboarder.
Okay.
But that all of a sudden I have the magazine, the video, the t-shirt graphics, the products, and I was connected. This was my thing.
And in Belgium, they were like old school scene. When did you come back or not of skateboarding?
There was some guy in my city. There was a generation that was maybe 6-7 years older. You know, like 80s skateboarder guys. And so they quit, sort of. You know,
also the style was different.
They were
more like sporties than punks, no?
There was some punk. Antwerp had some punks. We had this Stadspark, which is the city park. We had a skate park there.
Oh.
And you know...
At that time, in the 80s?
In the early 90s, yeah. But it started in the 80s, I think. But it was really crappy. The ramp was like this thin. It's like a U instead of a ramp, you know, like some plastic.
It was dangerous.
Super dangerous. No one skated it. We're just there and kids are smoking cigarettes and drawing on the grip tape and stuff. And that gave me, you know, my feeling. It was my connection, my subculture, you know. And so that was important, you know, to be in Belgium, to have that. If I didn't have that, I mean, I don't know who I would be, you know. And that's what's nice about all these subcultures. You know, our life is sort of like rich because of the people we know that are artists, that are creatives, you know, some skateboarding touches still, you know, we are lucky, you know.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
If you never started painting or something or doing graffiti, then.
Yeah, at the beginning I was in skateboarding, but also I was falling in love with the graphics and all these colors and no fire and punk stuff and.
Pusshead, we talked about Pusshead.
Yeah, but I discovered his name much time later because you didn't know the information. You saw, I have a bootleg from Sorlac, was like the hand of faith, that is this this hand with a skull inside by Pusshead. And I have this skate in Buenos Aires because I grew up in Buenos Aires.
Argentina. Yeah, that's right. I knew that, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. And then, after I discovered his name, but also similar things we have with Mina, because she was also kind of skateboarder and connected with punk music.
You grew up in Japan, yeah?
In Tokyo.
Nice.
And she have like...
Arigato gozaimasu.
She has some sort of like...
Shorts.
Shorts. with the graphics of Bosker.
Yeah, I remember that. Yeah,
and
yeah.
I said, wow.
This you is had me. Zorlak shorts?
Yeah.
What?
But also it's second hand because was gave, but from was from a singer of a band, really underground but famous in Japan, wow. Kokobat. And Kokobat is like a hardcore punk band from Tokyo. And the sleeves, I mean, the covers are made by Pathead.
No.
Because Pathead have or used to have a label for music called Bacteria or Bacteria Sur.
That I didn't know.
Because he was singing in another band in the 80s called Septic Death.
No shit, I didn't know that either.
Yeah, yeah, I was digging, I was discovering, is everything connected?
Yeah, yeah. And so you meet, where did you guys meet? In Barcelona, so you meet her, she has Zorlak shorts, you fall in love within one
second. No, before. Without the Zorlak, I fall in love.
Thanks to Pusset.
Yeah. But no, it's interesting the connection because I think Pusset have a partner or girlfriend or wife or whatever from Japan.
No. Dennis, what?
Yeah. Yeah, but he has his connection with Japan. He did the artwork for some bands in Japan.
Mad Japan.
I think, he's like a legend, but people know him because the Metallica stuff.
Yeah.
But he was doing a lot of artworks for other. I mean, even Dr. Dre. He was
Dr. Dre.
Yeah, yeah. He did a thing with the marijuana leaves and
stuff.
Yeah,
yeah,
and a skull. Mostly they are the skulls and skeletons.
Yeah.
But I mean, him, Jim Phillips from Santa Cruz.
Unbelievable.
Jimbo, we chat sometimes in the Instagram.
Shit.
He's so chill. I mean, I think the people from their school, they know that they grow up as, I mean, the legends as a rock stars because they have the support of the people like us.
You know? This is true. Yeah.
I mean, with Steve Caballero, he's also doing drawings and is going often to Japan. And we, exchange some texts. And he's so polite, I think. Yeah.
No, it's like what you said. Because back then,
they were so young. Also
so young, and if they connected to when we were young, you know, it was very different back then. Like back then, you had to. If I saw a kid wearing a T-shirt down the street, if that's a certain T-shirt, that's already my friend, even though I don't know this guy.
That's
how crazy it was.
It was crazy. Yeah.
Now everyone is looking cool, get the cool stuff.
I mean, no, you know. And they could be fake people because you can buy the stuff in the internet,
of course.
But before...
It was lifestyle behind it.
And as I say, I begin with the graffiti, with the skateboarding culture. And after I jump, because it was connected, because it was happening on
in the street.
Graffiti. And then when you saw somebody dressing like hip hop or with paint in the closet, you say, what do you write?
Yeah.
You know, you have a graffiti name.
Yeah.
It was common, but today you can see some, I mean, doesn't matter the look.
Yeah.
Could be anyone.
It changed. But in LA, there's still that culture a little bit left over, you know, like, what do you write? You know, it's like still like a thing that a lot of kids, when I'm painting walls there.
What do you write, nigga?
They're like...
they say to me,
they go,
hey. What do you write?
Hey, homie, what do you write? And then I go, because I want to be smart, you know what I mean? Because I see some kids 13 years old or whatever.
Yeah.
I say, I write short stories, emails, you know. And the kid is like, what? Because he sees me painting this big wall. So I fuck with him a little bit.
But they are a new generation of graffiti writers in LA? Or not that much?
There's some.
But it's so hard also, no? Because...
It's very prideful, you know. Graffiti in the States, there's a big pride in it.
Because you can go jail, no?
Yeah.
I mean, if they catch you.
Yeah, but then at the same time, I got friends here in Europe, you know, that did, you know...
Yeah, doing
crazy
stuff
they would never do over there. And, you know, everyone here is really relaxed about it. You know, so I noticed that when I moved there in 1995, that I'm like, I'm not really going to connect to that. You know, I really want to go into painting walls, you know, and hopefully try to figure it out. I figured it out over there because I was just tagging over here. But I was like, I need to do it sort of like separate from all that stuff, you know. Because I don't want to get into beefs and get, you know, into the violence.
It's really
and
like locals and stuff.
A little bit, yeah. And my route was... You know, I'm a conditional immigrant, you know, so I stopped stealing.
You cannot have tickets or go jet.
Yeah, I can't risk. I want to stay there. You know, so I can't steal anymore. I can't tag anymore. Yeah. And I'm definitely not going to go on missions, you know.
Yeah.
Because I really like the sunshine. I'm skateboarding. I'm in heaven, man. I'm skating my dream spots. I'm trying to make a life. So I found another way to do it. But my love was still for walls and spray paint. And so that created some horizon.
Another direction, another way, but with the same tools.
And with the same tools, yeah. So, yeah, for sure. Yeah, but the happy feeling that's in your work, I just love to see that, you know. And, you know, how much stuff have you done, man? Like, your catalog, if it would take how many days to look at everything?
Yeah, I did a lot of stuff, but I mean, I have this connection because I want to learn and to share the history of the not just me, just the graffiti movement or the culture,
right.
Contemporary culture. But I'm going, also see to the future. But yeah, I did, as you or people from our generation that they never stopped painting a lot of stuff.
Yeah, good stuff.
We were speaking with Mina last night. I say, okay, maybe we need to do a book sometime. But I think people is not reading books anymore. I mean, on paper, it's good that the sensation of smell, the ink,
and texture.
But who cares?
Yeah. Bowie did a book.
Yeah.
Did she Bowie's book? Wow.
It's the coloring book he wrote.
No, not the coloring book. That's one thing. No, he has a nice thick book.
But it's new.
It's already, I think it dropped. It was right when he moved to Mexico. So 5 years ago, 6 years ago.
Because we were with
really Bowie, nice book.
Last time was 2017. We did an exhibition in Mexico City when he was still living in Mexico City before he had a Gaston.
Yeah.
And I didn't know. I mean, he was...
It's really nice book. His ex-girlfriend, Janine, she was very, very good at layout.
So she did the design?
Yeah, she did the design of the book, but it's so nice, man.
And it's a compilation of his work?
It's everything he still has pictures of.
Because he
loses a lot of hard drives and stuff, but it's still a book like this. And it's
He's painting fast and he's painting a lot.
Yeah, that's what I like about him.
It's like a bomber style,
but you know, invisible spots, in good spots. Yeah, I like that.
And also, I think
he
gives this inspiration to all the new generations because when we were in Mexico, I saw stuff that was totally inspired by Bowie.
Oh, yeah, already. Yeah.
People, I cannot say. They copy, but they get.
There's been a few.
Yeah.
There's been a few that I've seen.
Yeah.
Because once you see it, it's like he thought of it and he's doing it. But to paint it, it's not the end of the world to paint those shapes, you know. So then, when you're a young kid, you're like, "Hey, I want to try that shape also." I see it's like that, and then that, you know, and you can do. And I've caught a lot of people sometimes online. Now I don't do it anymore. I say, "Hey, come on, man."
Yeah,
make up your own stuff.
But maybe because it's so, you can recognize easy the clear line. He told me his grandfather was an illustrator in Belgium, right?
Great. We have this comic. It's not a comic book.
Was in a newspaper or something.
It's not really found in other countries, I don't think. Because comic books are like thin paper. This is like big format, nice paper. Inked and colored, and there's a whole tradition. They call it stripverhaal. It's like bande dessinée in France, like you know, like this, Lucky Luke and all that stuff. But we had the Belgian equivalent.
It's from the 60s or 50s or something.
It started then, but there's certain titles, certain characters. They're on hundreds of copies, and used to be every week or every month, I think, a new one dropped. But it's hardcover. I mean, not the hardest cover, but not a soft cover either. Like Lucky Luke and Sammy and all these things.
Yeah.
And so his grandfather was, you know, the inker for one of those, the most famous ones.
Wow.
So he grew up around that.
Interesting.
Yeah. Sí, señor.
Interesting country, no? Belgium, the combination of stuff.
Yeah.
No, you have shitty weather, but you have good beer.
Great beer.
All this illustration background. And also the the producers, not the electronic producers.
Oh, yeah. Technotronic, man, from my city.
24/7, where they were from there, or was or Snap. Snap.
Snap is also from Belgium?
The producers, yes. Really? And also they did the combination, like you have a rapper, not doing it.
Oh, yeah.
If it's black, it's better because it's more from the Bronx,
but in
Europe.
Yeah.
And also a girl doing like the chorus.
Yeah, the choreography, Yo, pump it up. Boy, a guy in the back with early like techno or whatever. Pump it up good now. Come on. Like one of those guys.
Yeah. But you know what? I discovered that, for example, with Technotronic, the girl singing is like Milli Vanilli. It was a girl in the studio, but the girl dancing because she was underage or something like this. And the girl acting in the videos or on stage is another, it's another person.
So it's really a product.
Yeah, I mean, all these producers, they were so smart doing this.
This is true. I don't even mind like Milli Vanilli. It was a good song.
Yeah.
You know, like they I don't care if you sang it or not. What do I care?
The song
is a song.
Yeah, the song is a song.
Girl, you know it's true. Girl.
But they were like a new generation of producers in Belgium or not after this? Because it was like a boom at the end of the 80s, beginning of
like
the 90s.
To be honest, I was, like I said earlier, like, that we were like weed smokers, you know, and for some reason that scene
was pills,
you know, and we were literally just on the street kind of guys, you know, like no money, smoking some weed if we can hook it up, stealing, you know, from night shops.
Yeah, not going to clubs to eat pills.
We went. I have a beautiful memory. We had a crew in Antwerp. And it gets cold in the winter. So we had one basketball court, right, which is on the side of some kind of like a Catholic monastery or something. But for some reason, they didn't mind that we painted the walls, right?
It was like your Hall of Fame or something.
A little bit, but it was like very small Hall of Fame. Just like the plaza is like one basketball court, and the wall was the width of the basketball court. So all the kids with broken homes and immigrant kids were there playing basketball, smoking weed, talking bullshit, you know. And so at one point, you know, it started to get really cold, but there was this club called Pacific. And the music was not the worst, you know. It was kind of like acid house, a little bit of, you know, some cool stuff, an occasional like MC Solar song or something, Jazzmatazz, you know. So some nights we would go over there, like 30 kids, hoodies on, spliff, you know, whatever, backpacks, black books in the backpacks. And we would just get into this club for some reason because it was warm. And like a pack of dogs, we like would take the jacket off, hoodies on, we'd lay in the corner, someone's rolling hashish. Hey, you get a red marker, okay, red marker. Everyone drawing in the black books, looking at each other. And then looking at the dance floor at the girls. But we were so afraid to dance because we were young. You know,
but you was able to enter.
No? Yeah, and literally, like we were in the corner, literally like 30 like kids, like dogs, you know, but drawing in black book, smoking, you know, and just looking at the dance floor. And I remember that it was this one girl, I forget her name, a blonde girl, and she was the queen of this fucking disco club, you know, and just dancing by herself all the time. And then sometimes she would dance to a song that we liked, and we were like, oh, so stoned.
growing up in Belgium, man.
And so, yeah, that was a good memory, you know. That was a good memory. And how was it here in Barcelona? Because you always have this big tourism vibe, and, you know, it must have been fun.
I mean, in the 90s, maybe because I was also discovering stuff and I was so young, I have this romantic, you know, vision of the past, but also critic, because some stuff I think is, or I appreciate it more today. But what's more, my memories, they were Barcelona that was more wild, because...
Wild, yeah.
Wild, yeah. The city, they tried to sell it with the Olympic Games to the world. It was like a branding for the city, because before was more dirty, more...
What was that, 84? Was España Olympic?
No, it was 82, the football, the World Cup.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, and here was 92, 10 years after. But then was half of the population that we have today in the city. Then now it's overpopulated because it's not that big. But I'm doing now actually a documentary about the past of the last 40 years in the city, interviewing like some characters that they have connection with culture, some musicians, graphic designers, DJs, graffiti writers, activists, you know, to have this landscape, not this of the evolution of the city, people from here, Catalans, immigrants, but they saw the change of the city, because I think now the prices are high. I mean, this thing about the gentrification, that people that they...
Yeah, this is everywhere now.
It's everywhere, right? but now it's changing so fast.
I mean,
even you mentioned before Kreuzberg, first time I was in Kreuzberg, they were more like working class population and
people. You can get a flat for 300 euros.
Arabs, I mean, immigrants and whatever. But now, like everywhere, develops this posh stuff or touristic or and all the gentrification, you know, with all the new corporations coming there with their shops.
Yeah.
And then the people is moving, and then I don't know where we will go.
It's always like this. Like, you know, artists make a neighborhood interesting. They end up like doing cool events, they start painting outside, you know, we can't help it, right? And then all of a sudden, people that are not artists, they want to live there.
No, and they say, and also like, people like they have a business or they say, oh, I can open a coffee shop or whatever, a bar with cocktails.
Yeah. And one is okay, but all of a sudden when it's a 20, 30, 40...
But also that they copy the ideas, they are not original. I mean, this morning I was in a kind of record shop, but it's not like open to the public. It's you need to be invited by somebody because they don't have the license to sell records, whatever. And I love the sensation, you know, like you are like in the old city or in Berlin or whatever, somebody invite you and you go there and you dig some records. And it's not like, I open like a gin tonic bar because now everyone is drinking gin tonic and will be as successful.
Opportunistic.
Or now everyone is vegan and then I'm vegetarian for a long time, but I appreciate this. But this makes that some kind of people is coming here and you time to time you lose like the DNA of the city because at the end you have the same coffee shops, corporations in all the big cities today.
I mean
when I was in Venice, I was just one time in LA, I didn't feel like the spirit of the 80s.
It's finished, but the good thing, because
I saw some of the Dogtown guys and also Christian Hosoi and stuff, because I was in 2009 and they renovated the skate park
in
the beach.
Park,
and there was a great moment to see some of the legends. Even Jay Adams was there.
Wow, yeah.
But I feel it because we travel a lot with Mina.
Yeah.
We can
understand
what's done.
No, you know, because now everyone is there, man. It's Silicon Beach, they call it, because Silicon Valley... Like
Silicon Beach, they call it. Venice.
Yeah.
Wow.
You know, Snapchat has like...
Google, Facebook.
They own a whole neighborhood there. Google, so many buildings. Twitter is there.
But they build on in the channel.
They buy everything. And so it's double-edged, you know, because I've been painting in Venice 20 years. And so I know a lot of the people. And some people, you know, bought something 30 years ago for little money in the hope that one day... You know, we can sell and make some money. So now, you know, just like now, a lot of people are rich. But for the artists that were living in the spaces, they're like, fuck these fucking companies. You know, they come in here and also fuck this landlord who's now older, you know, like 60 years old now or something.
Yeah.
But the old man, like, give him a break too. You know, he took a risk 30 years ago.
Yeah.
And now he can sell his building for 3 million, 5 million. Fuck. Maybe... You can go on vacation now for once, you know?
But
and so it's double-edged, you know?
But you can feel the change, no?
Oh, yeah.
Because you arrived in the middle 90s there.
Yeah. I was skating in Venice every day, the old graffiti pits.
But it changed a lot, right?
And back then, it was dangerous. It was, you know, my ex, she woke up one morning. She lived in Venice. Opened up the door. There's a dead man.
In front of her door.
Like this, a lot of crack, a lot of... It was an artist's place. But there was a lot of, like, there was gang stuff. There was, you know, all kinds of weird stuff happening, which made it fun. Made it interesting, which made it Venice.
It wasn't like a
tourist destination like it is now. I mean, for skateboarders, it always was. But, like, things got really gentrified in a very crazy, weird way. You know, now Abbot Kinney, which used to be whatever, you know, it's the highest priced commercial real estate in the United States of America. It's more expensive to rent a space to open a store there than anywhere. And it's like, we, you know, to see that, right? And I'm sure that's why you want to make this documentary about Barcelona, because here you see the same effects. And it's like, wait a minute, what happened here? Like, how did that happen?
Also to show the people that they are from outside Barcelona, because also we interview skaters. Lee is a Korean.
You should talk to Enrique.
Yeah.
He's local.
Because change the city, and people always have this idea of Barcelona that is really holidays forever and good weather.
Yeah.
Good weather is true, but the local people, we suffer like the change of the city and the laws. And before, also, it was really connected with the squat places and organizing shows, I mean, concert gigs.
Right.
And this changed. Now, if you are a band, a new band, you know, that you want to play, you don't have places to play. You need to rent a club. Then change the way to absorb and to show culture to the people.
Yeah.
And then I want to explain the history about this change, because if we don't do it, I mean, people that were involved in different scenes, I think the institutional television, they don't gonna do it. I mean, other people, they don't have interest in this.
I
think it, from an anthropology view, it's interesting, because people could understand why we are now in this point, how we arrived here, because before they were some people pioneers that they were starting this or that. Now everything is so fast.
Yeah, everyone is like, you know, likes to absorb a culture, right? A lot of spectating, a lot of enjoying of the culture. But people have to be mindful that certain earth, certain soil creates good fruit, right? Good trees, good plants, good. And it's the same in the city, is the same.
Mm.
You know, if you make it all super difficult, and like you said, a new band can't really find a place to perform in, then you're destroying the thing that you're enjoying, right? And that's a big problem.
Yeah, in this city, for example, because they want to get like quick money with the tourism, they don't care about the local, we can say, producers. I mean, the local people doing their own culture, you know, because Barcelona, the good thing, or the Mediterranean culture, is we spend a lot of time on the street. Then they develop street cultures, you know, like skateboarding is an example that people know here in Magba is an international skate spot because all the videos and all the pros are amateurs. They are skating there. But before was also the street art or graffiti thing. We have all these things. But I think for the institutions, it's not important, or they don't care, you know? It's more for, other layers of society. But I think it's important to have this legacy. I mean, to show that this was happening here. I think somebody will be doing something in Venice. We got all this culture because it's crazy. We met an old schooler, graffiti writer, but also singer from a hardcore punk band in Osaka, in Japan, and he was living end of the 80s in Venice.
Wow.
And he met Excel and Suicidal Tendencies, all these skate related punk bands, and he was hanging with Chicanos, you know. And then when he came back to Osaka, he started a band called Corrupted. And he was singing in Spanish.
Wow.
Because I say, why are you singing
Japanese
in Spanish? Why are you singing in Spanish? I say, because all my friends in Venice, they were Latinos, you know? And then he started, he was one of the pioneers in Osaka. His graffiti name is Cosa, but Heavy is his nickname. He was the original singer of Corrupted. He had all this inspiration from Venice.
Yeah.
And then I think Venice was a gold mine, you know, oh, because all this electric boogaloo, this movie about breakdancing with Ice-T
at
the beginning, with Jean-Claude Van Damme dancing at the beach, even Thrashing.
Thrashing, yeah. Josh Brolin was the lead actor in. I love Josh Brolin.
Yeah.
I didn't realize that up until.
One of his first movies.
Yes.
Yeah. The Dagger. Thrash It
was when there was no skate videos even, and that came
was
out.
This and the Another World and Lame Cube. But here they
Gleaming the Cube
because here they translate so weird.
Yeah,
but
hey, conoces la skate spot a la Venice Beach? Oh, vámonos. Quiero cerveza? Sí. And it's like
yeah, Venice with all this wall painted.
Man, that place was golden, man. The Venice graffiti pits. Wow, unbelievable place. Nuts.
So now it's gone. It's just this little wall with the tower, and that's it.
Yeah, I heard. And I have to verify this, that it's all still there. They just put sand on top.
No, it's not true. The walls in the...
Because what you see, the little top like this, the chimney, is the chimney from... Because I remember there was chimneys, something there, like barbecue pits in the original Venice graffiti pit. There was a stage and barbecue pits. Right? For like, you know, like...
But then they put a lot of sand and they put it up.
I heard they put like 20 tons of sand on top. So I think, I will ask, but I will figure it out. It's still there. Start digging. I'm going to give everyone shovels. We're going to dig it out.
Yeah.
I think that's true, that the original graffiti pit is still there. But it just became too dangerous. Because there was a lot of like small walls. There was like people shooting up. We would like find needles there all the time. You know, like heroin stuff. And it's just easy to like, it's easy for violence and like, you know, junky shit. And it was just the structure of it was very, I think that's why they ended up like putting sand and then building the skate park next to it or something like that.
Because before this skate park wasn't there. I mean, when you arrived there.
No.
Was the when they released the skate park was 2009? You remember? No, because that's when I was there.
No, it was
maybe
earlier,
before, and they rebuilt it or something.
That skate park was not there. There was no skate park.
No skate park. No. Just the avenue. I mean, where you are, the people are walking.
Yeah, but there was this structure called the Venice Graffiti Pit.
Yeah.
It was like
some banks and some stuff.
Yeah, it was like ledges and some stone tables and a stage.
Yeah, I remember.
Everything made from
movies.
Concrete, exactly from that. And I think it was 2000 and what was it? I forget. 1, 2, or 3 or something. They opened the skate park.
Okay.
Yeah. Or maybe a little bit later even. Maybe it is 2009. Could be. Was it? I don't know. Yeah. So what do you think is the way, you know, like how can you influence, you know, how can you inspire... You know, like you talked about the institutions, you know, people, local government, to realize that, hey, don't squash, don't make it so sterile, don't make it so corporate.
But I think the problem is not...
Is there a way even? Or like, is it just going to pop up somewhere else?
It's the mentality. It's the mentality of people that, I mean, power corrupts. I mean, people on the establishment, they don't, I think... Most of them, this race of people, they just think about money and profit, and then they don't understand that they have this profit because they were like a culture or subculture or people doing stuff in the city that make like goes. I mean, people coming from everywhere because we were developing something fresh.
Yeah.
But they don't are so smart to understand this.
Yeah.
But I think it's happening everywhere because first time I went to New York, I was surprised that I didn't find graffiti anywhere.
Yeah.
I mean, just bombing, some shops painted by Dutch crew, but that's it. Where are the massive productions of the... They were gone.
Yeah.
I mean, they have, during the end of the 70s, beginning of the 80s, till the end of the 80s, when they were really hard against the graffiti and the subway,
yeah.
They have all this evolution and connection. You can imagine Afrika Bambaataa coming from South Bronx,
yeah.
Going to the Soho, hanging with the Talking Heads. It's a crazy combination,
nuts,
you know?
Yeah.
Or even when we met Futura with The Clash, or with Blondie.
Nuts. It's a goosebumps right now. Look at this. Right away, just think, yeah.
Yeah, and you, this was happening, but if you see like the history of the city of New York, for example, they were like in a depression, economic depression, yeah. End of the 70s, all these things. They are like a cyclic, you know, you have these cycles, and I don't know. I think now the cycles are more going faster, but I think we need, for example, in our culture, more people that they take care about the history, you know? So I don't know if to document, but to take the legacy to give like to the next generation, right. Because I saw with the new generations that I'm going out to paint or when we exchange ideas or whatever, they don't have this interest in the history, or not in the history like I'm in the library reading books, yeah. To understand we are here because before we were there, yeah. And some people started, no, before, yeah. We mentioned Futura or whatever, or Phase 2 that he passed away last December, rest in peace, that somebody created. Now you are, if not copying, inspired by, yeah. The beginners, yeah, yeah. You know?
Because there's so much of it now, and maybe when we got started or the beginning, we had to search for, we had to really defend even, right? And people... We have to explain to everyone what it is that we're doing, even, you know, even though we are not the first generation, but,
yeah, 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 yeah,
but
yeah.
We had pride in that. Like,
and we respect defended. Like, yeah. The old schoolers, and we have respect for the culture, and we try to learn every time we have the opportunity. And I think now, I don't know if it's like a internet thing or something, that people don't care about the to learn more. It's just I consume, yeah. And next. Yeah, I want the next project, and then I think you lose like the magic of the discover and, yeah. to try to learn.
Yeah. Yeah,
I don't know.
Yeah, it's a weird one, because I imagine if I'm like 17 now, right, or even 50 now, and I have Instagram and I start following, you know, some stuff, and maybe I start to go out or whatever, and I look in one scroll of the Instagram feed, I see more in 1 minute than we did,
yeah.
When we were like, sure. 13 or 14 or 15, you know?
Yeah,
we see more information, more possibility, more flavor.
I think there's more information, but they didn't digest well. I mean, right. you saw a lot of images, but I remember when we saw the first fanzines, photocopy fanzines, and After Color, the first graffiti magazines in Europe, I remember like the graffiti pieces, the background. Oh, is this a spot? There, yeah. Are these tags. We, yeah. Memorize all the images.
Yeah, 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 yeah.
You think that all the new generation, they can memorize all the images they,
too much.
They see?
Yeah.
It's impossible.
You cannot do it.
And then
we get a little bit at a time, and it's like cuisine, you know?
Yeah, yeah.
And they are fast food, eat.
Now it's really, yeah. I didn't think in this way, but it's kind of fast food. I mean, it's good that we are, it's open, and in a way it's more, we can say, democratic, that people have a connection with information and with another cultures, and easy to listen to music or, yeah. Discover stuff. But I think people lose the interest on the roots of,
yeah.
The thing.
Because, you know? There's no effort that needs to be done. Like you said, you just went digging, you know, it was a private thing, blah, blah, blah. And that, you know, back then it was like that as well. We had one record shop in Antwerp. And I remember with my friends, every Friday the new releases drop, right? And school in Belgium ends at 5. So I would like be ready in the class.
To go after the...
on my bicycle. And I knew, oh, he's already there. Fuck, I got to catch up. And then I would take a trash bag, throw it at him in the street so he would fall. So I could get to the record shop first.
Because
there's only three copies. And the DJs who are older than us.
They were already there.
They already got it, you know? And so it's like, you got to fight for it, you know?
Yeah.
And when you have to fight for something, or like a good skinny cap or something.
Yeah, we're
talking basic shit here.
Yeah.
You had a good skinny cap, you put that in White Spirit, you save that skinny cap. You know?
Yeah.
And now it's just like, you just order online, you know? Or Spotify or something. You get the whole catalog of whatever you want. You just click the button.
But I think they don't listen to all the albums to discover all the... I don't know.
And it's okay, you know.
It's okay. It's another way.
But I... because before we know it, we sound like bitter old men. Like in my day, you know.
but there's
something beautiful about the way it was, and we would wish that they can have that too. You know, in
the golden years.
Yeah.
The
and also the beard goes.
The good old days.
I think I got more gray now.
Yeah, me too. But no, it's another way to consume the culture. But I think it's so fast. Even with the Instagram, we have Instagrams as well, but. And we are posting stuff, but this is too fast and to people learn or understand the hours and the dedication that there is behind, you know?
Right.
Because you see just a square picture from a big wall and say, okay, scroll down next.
Yeah.
But before we were, as you say, cuisine, no? We were taking the taste and enjoying the flavor. Now it's more, next product. But this, if you extrapolate this to other things in society nowadays, it's the same as the relationships.
Yeah.
People, they don't have like patience or, I don't know, mentality to respect each other. They are more, no, with all these apps to meet people, girls.
Yeah. Dating apps and stuff,
Dating apps.
It's catalog.
Yeah,
catalog.
And it's like, okay, I have an album of how many... body facts I have. Come on, man. I'm looking for something else in my life.
Not
just to fill my ego with how many girls I've
Yeah, because then at the end, you know, you have so many, like, let's say, mutual likes that you're like, okay, I don't even know which one to take now.
Yeah.
You know, and what, you know, then you don't do anything, you jerk off.
Maybe it's happening like this, eh? Mina never tried as well. We met some time ago. Yeah, they went west at the beginning of the apps, the meeting apps.
And how long have you guys been together?
8 years.
8 years, wow. This is very good. Nice.
Yeah.
Fantastic, I'm happy for you guys.
Yeah, I mean, the good thing when we met with Mina also is that we were not really young and stupid. We have like some experience with in different cultures, different countries, with different partners. And then I think we met in the right moment, you know, and she was already painting. And I was surprised when I was first time in her mother's house in Tokyo, digging on her CDs. They have a lot of music I was listening to, you know, but extreme music, I mean, hardcore punk stuff. I was, whoa, I mean, classics, Black Flag, Dead Kennedys, but also... another stuff,
and it's
not that common to find like a partner that listens the same music.
Plus the Zorlak shorts.
Zorlak.
Plus, like, you guys' styles, it's coming from this very similar feeling.
Yeah.
On top of that, and now you can work together, it's a little bit heaven for you guys.
I work. They are from Mina.
Oh, yeah.
She's still connected with the skate a little bit. Yeah.
I found some Airwalk Vicks. Remember
but
Vicks?
They are doing reissues? Or?
They reissue, but they don't make the good one.
Bad quality or bad
no,
shape?
No, I want the old one. I want the Fahrenheit.
I want
540.
Yeah.
But I found some Vicks. You know the Vicks?
Yeah.
I bought them with the flap, original flap.
Wow.
I had when I was a kid, and I have to buy these. And so I ran into them. Some shop in Berlin had them.
Titus, no.
It wasn't Titus, no. But someone, it was someone. I'm like, where is this coming from? So I bought right away. And I wore them, and whenever I'm in LA and there's some old school skaters around, I'm like, don't look at my eyes. Look down. look at my shoes. They're like, what? What is that?
But they still like some old school skaters in LA or not?
They're still, they're around, Yeah,
but you can see some of the old pros around, or
like some friends are like artists, you know, like Andy Howell, Steve Size.
Because Andy Howell was from LA or from San Francisco.
He was from Atlanta.
Oh, okay.
And he just did. Remember New Deal, the company?
Yeah.
He just put on a show
because he was being a pro, but also he was doing the
graphics.
Artwork.
Yeah, and so. We got a lot of influence from those graphics because in 1991, those kind of hip hop graffiti
characters,
right?
Yeah, the spray can I remember.
Yeah, that's all Andy's artwork. So recently he did a big show. What was it? 25th anniversary of New Deal, the company, at Shepherd Fairey's Gallery. So we all got together and everyone was there and, you know, a little bit older, of course.
Yeah.
And
because New Deal was a company. by him or no other?
It was a company that he started with.
He started
with Douglas. It was like a partnership, right? But it was sort of never done before, right?
But like, was connected with Rocco or no?
It was not connected with Rocco. This was connected with Paul Schmidt, who was part
of Professor Schmidt.
Exactly.
Voilà. He's still not doing the shapes.
Yeah.
I love this guy.
I love this guy too. And it, Schmidt was Schmidt Sticks. And then Steve Douglas, I think, was the business guy, I think. And Andy
was the artistic.
Was the artistic guy. And it was like he had the whole East Coast to South, like Atlanta vibe. So all of a sudden that jumped up on the scene and it was a response to the corporate skateboarding, like Powell Peralta and all that stuff. There was no real skater-owned companies yet. And so...
But it's most of the same time of Blind and all
this. Blind was a few years later, but it was very close. It was like Rocco then, you know, did his thing. I think it was maybe... Back then it seemed like forever, 1 year, you know?
One
summer was like 10 years.
Yeah, because they were like releasing decks every month.
Yeah.
I mean, because I have the disposable book by...
The disposable art, yeah.
Yeah, disposable art.
The graphic.
What's the name of the... Seeing Cleaver.
Sean Cleaver. I met him. He was at the show.
Ah, yes?
Yeah.
He's a legend also. But I like the book because he... It speaks about his experience. That's the thing I like, and I want to document the things and to share with the audience, with the people, because he was in the last years of the golden years of Paul Peralta, and after the skate business changed.
Yeah.
Because some of skaters, they start their own company.
Exactly. Yeah.
But George Powell was so angry. He didn't like the...
Oh, of course not, because business is crumbling and he was already an old man.
But also the mentality changed.
Yeah. The mentality changed, skating changed, the tricks changed.
Everything.
It went from like the ramp stars like Hosoi and everyone else to now it's like real street skating.
Yeah. Gator in jail.
All that kind of stuff. So it was a very interesting moment in time and products changed.
Yeah, I remember.
Style change.
Yeah, the skateboards with nose, with tail, with this big nose.
Yeah.
I have a Natas at that time, Santa Monica. Natas.
I had a meeting with Natas years ago.
He's also drawing.
Yeah,
no?
He was our director for Quicksilver, and I think he still is. But he did the Nirvana album cover.
Nirvana?
Yeah, he was art director on that.
I didn't know. Which one?
Never mind. Yes, the Baby in the Water. That was his art direction.
No.
Yeah.
No way.
Natas is something. Yeah. Natas is quiet, but he's
Satan.
Wow.
No?
Yeah. In Europe, everyone's like, hey, backwards is Satan.
Yeah. But you know what? Dave the Chim, when we were last time in his studio in Berlin, 2015, he was showing us some prototypes that after they went into production for Natas.
Mm.
He did for, what was this brand? Prime or some of these brands.
Oh, not no, 101. He skated for 101 for a second. He had the Pentagram Slayer graphic.
He did like the Tiger thing, all the stuff. Yep. He did like three versions, I think, Dave. Mm-hmm. He was so proud, of course. Doing like
David Chim did?
Yeah. I mean like
the graphic?
Yeah, the reissue of the old graphics his own style.
Nice.
Because Dave is a good guy also. He told me that because I saw he was painting a half pipe for the Santa Cruz, the Screaming Hands 30th anniversary.
Yeah.
And then I love Jim Phillips. I say, oh man, I want to participate. How is going on? Because also Fortress was involved in the Berlin show. And they told me they are going to Spain, to Barcelona to do a show, like 1 or 2 days pop up. And I connected with the people from Santa Cruz here, the people doing the license.
Yeah.
And I did a graphic for the third anniversary, and Santa Cruz liked it, and they produced a T-shirt.
What?
Yeah.
Big up.
Yeah.
I love that.
It was like a dream.
Yeah. Those are special moments, you know.
We grow up with this culture, we really respect and appreciate all this.
Yeah, that's when you can do that and now you're a little bit a part of it, that's fantastic. It's a proud moment.
And also I've been in the factory of Santa Cruz in 2009, 10 years ago.
Nice,
and I have a tour inside the production.
Yeah.
And they were screening some of the Jason Jesse Neptunes at that time because they did like a small run of silkscreen print. Now it's everything
It's really weird. Yeah.
I mean, it's not shit, but it's cheaper.
It's actually pretty shit because, let's say, for the artwork, right? If it's not silkscreen, after 2 years, you hang it on the wall or something, the graphic fades. You know, just it's not light fast or something. There's some technical thing about it. It's good to skate. Nice graphic. It looks good.
But the hanging on the wall is light.
The light like eats away the color.
Yeah. have some hanging, but it's not going. Yeah, the sunlight direct to the.
Yeah, heat transfer graphics.
Yeah, because yeah. I bought. Yeah, I mean I bought some.
I would try to protect them because I did some also and. Oh man, why is this fading? You know, it's just hanging in the house.
Because it's the you print like a paper you transfer.
Yeah. And I guess there's different qualities.
Yeah.
There's different qualities like
the best is a screen print.
Of course,
but it's more expensive.
It's I don't know how much more expensive it is, but it's worth it. It's definitely worth it.
I mean, I started to collect when I was in the factory, because I have reconnected with my early culture with the skateboarding. And I think it's like this. They are like a screen prints.
Yeah.
The same as screen boards.
Yeah.
You know, screen decks. They are like a piece of art.
Are a piece of art. Yeah. I love that stuff.
Now they are expensive, no? Because people, like, they are older than us. They are, no? They are 50s or 50 something, and they have this. Oh, my childhood, whatever. They're spending a lot of money on this.
Because now they can afford to buy.
They can afford it, but I mean, it's crazy. Yeah. They are like bidding. I mean, come on, we belong to the same culture. Yeah. Don't be stupid.
Yeah.
I mean, like.
Yeah. It depends. Like for a minute, I thought it was really nice to hang a board on the wall, you know, as an artwork. But now I don't think it's like the best thing anymore. You know what I mean? Like, say in your house, you have a skateboard hanging there. You know what I mean? It's a little bit.
Yeah, I can show you. After.
No, I also, but.
But you change your mind.
It's a little bit difficult sometimes, you know. But it's I appreciate it, but like it's hard to find like a proper good spot because it's. I can't get away from the fact that I feel the art, but it's still a skateboard hanging on the wall, and aesthetically, there's something.
It's a little
difficult. It's a little young, maybe, you know, to do that. You know what I'm saying?
You're becoming
I'm getting old.
Yeah,
I'm getting even more gray now.
You're getting old, man. Yeah. I don't know. Maybe the old pros, they have some hanging
skateboards
somewhere. I don't know. Sometimes I check the Christian Hosoi account and he had a lot of pro models, no? How many?
Oh, yeah.
But he's just speaking about God. It's boring for me. I'm not in this... stage of my life.
But what's always interesting when you speak about God, you know.
I mean, like trying to colonize with your idea.
A little bit.
I'm sharing. I'm not saying that God is the best.
Yeah.
It's your option if you want to believe.
But there's another way to do it where you don't mention God. You know what I mean?
Steve Caballero does like this because Steve Caballero. Yeah. Is really Christian, but he's not trying to evangelize.
Yeah.
He's saying, you need to share love with each other and like this.
When I read that God stuff, come on, let's go party, let's do some crazy shit, let's do all the bad stuff, and then we'll talk about God. You know,
yeah,
I did get a little anti too. You know,
but like, this is something like really that is happening in US. I also with the old rappers, Curtis Blow is also.
Yeah?
Rapping Curtis Christian Mo? Stuff, no, and even Melly Mel or some of the classics.
Melly Mel?
Yeah, because I think they even run from Run DMC. He's a priest.
Yeah, he's a priest.
He's
a priest. He's a reverend.
Yeah,
Reverend Run.
It's Reverend Run. I mean, I think they did all the stuff they can do, like fuck all the good ladies. They do all
and
the
drugs. And I feel bad about it.
Now they want to be... forgive.
Say, Brian's not gonna tell me what to do. I haven't fucked them all yet.
But I don't understand. If you do this comparison, you don't have this in Europe. I mean, people still like rock stars or not rock stars, but people that they enjoy their life, they are not trying to connect with God to go to the paradise. Come on. Yeah.
No, it's. I would like to, you know. I mean, I would like to talk to them in person, but I think it's. Weird to do anything like that, like publicly so much.
For me, it's embarrassing. I mean, to see like all, like we can see our teenage inspirations, Speaking about God, come on, so boring.
It is very boring.
It's very, but for example, I follow Glenn Friedman, you know, the photographer.
Yeah, Glenn E. Friedman.
Glenn E. Friedman. Yeah. I think he's interesting, his point of view, because he's all almost same age, because he was younger than them. But is he, in each pose with the photographs, he's trying to share this moment in life, you know, you have with the rappers, with the skaters, with the breakdancers, with the punk rockers. But he's not saying, like, this is the truth.
Yeah.
The truth about God and my past.
You know what it is? Like, Josoy is sober, you know, and in the AA program, I have a number of friends that are a part of it. One of the steps is to realize that there's something bigger than you, right? And the placeholder for that is God, right? It's a program that was started in the 50s, you know.
But it's to brainwash people.
Not brainwash. It's just when you're addicted to substances and you fuck over your family, your friends, you steal, you disrespect yourself and everyone you know, you think you're the king of the world, right? You need something like that, right?
But you cannot, for example, come back to do a skateboard or do, I mean, painting, something creative or help people on the street, not to think, oh, this something superior than me, it's going to help me.
But here's the thing, like, so in Alcoholics Anonymous or Narcotics Anonymous, there is that God factor, right? Even though the guys that started it, I heard, they got the idea in the 50s, I think, while they were out tripping on, or in the 60s when they were tripping on acid. They were tripping on
acid. They had the idea to connect with God?
Well, when you trip on acid, you are connected with God. You know what I mean?
With the next planets,
you know what I mean? To name it is like, I know there's something else going on, you know? I don't know if you've done anything psychedelic.
Yeah, LSD, yeah.
Yeah, so you know there's something else happening here, right? If you want to label that God and that helps you, that's fantastic.
Yeah,
but if...
There are energies, not God, a Christianity, and...
This is my problem also. But when all of a sudden, it's the club is... What football club is it? Is it AC Milan? Oh, no, it's Christian. Oh, no, it's Catholic. Oh, no, it's this. Then it becomes like... The label for me is not necessary, but I appreciate that you feel a connection to something. It signals to me that you want to be a good person, which is fine by me, but just like, it's still a crutch, I think, you know, it's still like a little weakness, I think.
But it's crazy because I'm thinking,
and I mean that in the best way, weakness in the best way.
In another pioneers from skateboarding, and they are, I mean, with the word of God, Tony Alva, for example, the same.
Also,
he did that tour.
He's probably also sober. Is he sober?
He did that, sure.
There's a link there with
bands in Buenos Aires, in Mar del Plata, in a city on the beach close to Buenos Aires, where we were doing a talk. And people, they want to listen to the stories, the old days.
And he talks about God.
In the God Town, Lord Town, and God.
Jay
Adams, the last years of his life. Yeah. God, you know, then why? Natas is speaking about God. I don't think so. He's further. Mark Gonzalez is about God. No, they are intelligent. You know, Jason Lee is talking about God.
But here's the problem: like a lot of intelligent people, you know, believe in God. You know. And it could be any kind of God. Could be, you know, Yahweh. Could be Prophet Muhammad. Could be Vishnu, Shiva, the Buddha. You know, and I think it's okay. But I agree with you. It feels a little weird when you were this massive rock and roll dude, like hijinks all over the place, inspired millions of people around the world, and now you feel like you have to tell everyone about God. You know, like the problem is that
I don't want to listen to this. But it's not interesting for me.
The problem with God, I think, is if God will find you, trust it, you know. Like, who could have told Josoy when he was 17, raging around, hey, man, God. He would have said, fuck off, pal, you know. I'm going to fucking do my thing. And so I think that needs to be realized. You can't force anyone into anything, right? No. You can, you know, it's a little bit useless to mention the brand God all the time, right? I think. You really don't like it.
God we trust. It's really some American.
Yeah. But it's bullshit. Most of these politicians, I mean, they don't, you know. I mean, there's church-going people. They just need some kind of a codex in life. Sure. But man, don't you have the compass inside you? Don't you know when you do something bad? It's built into us, right? Why do you, you know? I think it's business stuff, you know? It's a little bit like I'm part of this club, and I don't think any politician for a long time can be elected, or maybe now it's possible. If they're single, imagine a single person is the president. A person that does not talk about God cannot be elected. But that's so old school, right?
It's old school. We are.
Let's get modern with
new
it.
Mentality. More open mind. Yeah, for me, it's kind of weird that all these inspirational people have this. Yeah, to speak about this. I mean, it's okay. They don't need to.
It's
speak
a weird one
about,
it's like,
about all the gold, the golden years and whatever, the old days. They can, I don't know how, for example, Tony Alva, no, how I'm like 50 something or 60s, I don't know his age. I'm still doing skateboarding and I did my own company and I'm still, skating, you know, I'm still riding. Yeah. I think it's more interesting than talk about something.
Because it's like, then you wonder, like, how do you experience this thing you call God? God is a word. Right?
It's
okay. Well, what do you feel? Who is God to you? Is it a guy with a beard? Or is it the feeling you get? And the feeling you get must be love. And if it's love, then you're a hippie. You can be a hippie.
Yeah, I'm a hippie, but I don't call it God. Yeah. But for example, some years ago we were also in Thailand and in Vietnam, and I'm not really a religious guy, but I connect with the Buddhism, for example.
Yeah, I love
it. Because it's a religion that they respect the other gods, multiple gods, not just monotheist, just one god. This is our god.
Polytheistic.
And not like our god is better than yours. This is stupid. Yeah. This make wars. This make problems.
And it has thousands of years.
But then is the thing that I believe that is some energy and some love and whatever. But I don't call it God.
Right.
Yeah, it's another thing.
Or it's virtual reality. We're in a computer program. We're playing the video game.
We don't know. Yeah, Matrix.
Wow.
We are here. Yeah.
So it's nice. I like when it comes to all that stuff, I like to put question mark there. Right. But to say, Jesus or this or that, it's like, okay, man, how sure can you be? Are you really sure about that? Really? Would you bet your child's life on that? Right. Let's say.
Not
careful.
Me.
Not me.
Yeah. I'm going.
Better to be open.
Yeah, I will tell you. I'm going to Jerusalem in 2 weeks.
Yeah, you're gonna do a project, huh?
Yeah. Let's see. Yeah. I don't know when they're gonna release this.
If you want, we can do it before or after.
No. Yeah. Let's see what's going on.
You got something interesting there? A God project?
No, it's not God project. No, but I want to.
You're gonna paint a wailing wall.
But to do a wall, making people have questions when they saw because this also we have this is for another chapter about what is the direction that is going the mural thing the street art.
Where do you think it's going?
Now it's really mainstream and we can say in some ways commercial. It's good in some ways for us because we could professionalize because before we were surviving doing different kind of stuff. But I don't know the future. I think we need more people like is curators or people writing, like taking care of the history of the movement. Because I saw more and more people that they don't know about the history.
How it all came to be.
I mean, there's like this guy in US, Roger Gassman, that he did the shows, and I think
he's kind doing of a good job.
Also, is this Adrian, this guy that he used to organize the in Berlin the back jumps life issues. He used to do the magazine, and after he was doing like more physical exhibitions. But I think we need more people like this. Like they have respect, and they are coming from inside the culture because people from outside the culture they have another point of view,
right.
And they don't feel the same.
And they're gonna miss the details and everything.
Yeah. Then is. I'm an artist, but I want to take care if I had the opportunity of these details, if I could do a documentary, or now I'm preparing an exhibition of a graffiti pioneer from here, from Barcelona. His name is Saif. He started in 1984. He's one of the pioneers. They are really old schools. I started the beginning of the 90s. I will not say I'm old school because for me, the old school in Barcelona is the 80s.
80s, yeah.
And I'm trying to organize a show with him with some of his sketches. He's doing sketches today, pictures, to people understand that I started painting because I saw pieces like this guy, you know, or other guys that same generation.
That was the fire that came into you, yeah.
Because I was doing like writing on the wall is something like natural from human race, I think, yeah. Since the times, yeah. Like in the caves or in
cave
Rome.
Cave paintings, yeah, yeah.
They were people.
The caves of Altamira.
Altamira, yeah. People, they were writing on walls because we need to express. But I think this, it was our, Dogtown, you know. These people, or people like in New York, like starting on the subway. And when we met after the years, like Days or Crash, or this year we met last year, Tats Crew. They were some of the pioneers, you know. We have a lot of respect because they still around doing stuff, and they are so simple. I mean, so open. They are not thinking, "Oh, I'm the master creator or something."
I was really nervous because I was last year. I was in how many days I forget, but I was in China with Futura.
Wow!
And we did a project there with other artists. Matt Stees was there. Bode was there. Who else was
also Motu or Bates?
They were
in China, but not together.
They go all the time, I think. But and I'm like, okay, I know I'm gonna meet Futura, you know. And there he is at the headquarters, you know. There's a bar built in, and so nervous. And then from the first moment I say hello, you know, it's just warm person, humble person, funny person. Just talking like we're talking. Unbelievable. But I'm
so
like,
simple.
Man, this guy, you know, it's like levels to this thing, you know, to this person, you know. And just the coolest, most down to earth. And just Lenny, such a nice guy.
Yeah.
Unexpected. Because if anyone can be to be like big head about things.
But I think he had his high moment in the 80s, but after. He needs to he grow up his family, you know, kids and something, and in New York and
Paris,
and then he worked hard and
worked really well.
And the chat we have together was interesting because he made like this view of the evolution of the movement in a way, because his life
is
painting
that?
Is the evolution,
yeah,
you know,
it,
like he was doing the banner for the Clash, you know, when they were in New York or in Europe, he was touring with them. But also, he said when we were painting in the 80s, you know, with Jean-Michel and all the guys around, Papa Freddy, they were more, in a way, more rebel because there was a rebellion movement.
It was a rebellious act to spray paint.
Yeah, right. But then he understand that in US, they weren't taking care of the, as we say, of the pioneers of this. He have a lot of success in Japan or in Europe.
But he had to go to outside to
Have the recognition. Yeah. But then because when we met, he was doing a workshop for Levi's. He was doing some back jackets. I said, but now in my country, they understand the companies that we are culture, you know, we have history and we did history for this moment and for the country because New York is known, worldwide known because the graffiti subway culture, you know, and then I think he could be an ambassador of, I mean, he is of the New York culture.
Yeah, but it'd be nice if there was an official title that he could get.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like, you know, like, why not?
Yeah,
there's enough
yeah.
room for that, right?
Yeah. And, but we need in the institutions people like have this vision, you know?
Yeah. Like, I just got a random weird idea. Like, let's say, for example, you in Barcelona, you know, you become part, you get an official title and a salary. No, but why not?
The embassy of the Zulu Nation.
Zulu Nation. But like you're involved with actual government and they give you a position to sort of create projects for the city with official budget.
Mm.
I mean, this is, to me, this is the most normal thing when I think about it. And yet it's not happening, you know? And like a guy like Futura, give him, you know, and it's a position you hold maybe for 3-4 years. right? And Futura invites friends and artists and creates projects in the city, officially backed by the city with official budgets. And resources and he has an office and whatever he needs.
This could be good, but I think most of the artists, they don't want to do this job. I mean, me, because I'm passionate about the history and the culture.
I don't know if they wouldn't want to do the job. I think the job doesn't exist, so people aren't thinking about it.
Yeah. But I mean, the artists, they want to create their art and enjoy their free time and whatever.
That's true.
But this is something that you need to have patience to live with another artist, you know, because the artists are hard sometimes, you know. But they can recommend. I know that Dave told us that he was giving some ideas for this Get Down series from Netflix.
Right.
Because he was painting at the end of the 70s and he was in the Bronx and he was giving some tips, you know. And he's,
consulting and stuff.
Yeah, consulting, yeah. And I know that after when he passed away, phase two, he was consulting for the Beat Street movie they were painting the trains and stuff. And even in the Wild Style movie, the character that was made by Fat Five Freddy, that his name in the movie was Fade, originally was a character to phase two, but phase two he didn't want to show his face he didn't like the word graffiti, you know. He was saying writing.
Yeah, interesting. Yeah.
Yeah, or the art of spray or something like that.
But graphine in Greek means to write.
Also in Latin, graffito.
Graffito. Interesting.
But I it's the same like punk label in some journalists in England. They start to write, and then at the beginning
it catches on.
People they don't.
They say it's not. Yeah, because we need to label things and organize things. And what is that?
Okay, but it's the same for us when they say street art, we don't like this label anymore. Yeah. I think at the beginning we don't care because we were doing the evolution of the graffiti we were doing. But now it's kind of commercial, it's always
a weird word because I always thought like, you know, a guy playing accordion with hat. For money in the street, that's also street
art. It's happening on the streets.
Mime, you know, it's all street art. But it's just a weird. It sounds weird. It feels weird, right?
Yeah. And also they were using it before. I think street art or urban art or something. Related with the space.
Yeah. Who knows, my man Zosen.
We arrived to the moment.
Yes, this is a good moment, I think.
Yeah, to say goodbye and to the next.
Because you have things to do.
To the next chapter.
The next chapter, man. Yeah. So where can people look you up online?
The Instagram is the thing that's more updated than my website. Yeah, sosenbandido.com. Sosen, this is the website, but Instagram. Sosen Bandido or Mina Hamada.
Mina Hamada.
We were working together sometimes, also alone. And we hope that in the future we cross the paths.
Okay. Yes, same here, man. Thanks for doing this. And on to the next one.
Okay.
Bye-bye.
Bye.
Boom, that was Zosen. Hope you dug that. Really love that he's preserving the culture and, you know, keeping a... you know, making sure that things are recorded, you know, and preserved. That's a whole other mission. You know, everyone's always busy painting, but to do that extra stuff, that's just where the love comes out. And I really appreciate him and his work and all his work. So hope you got something out of that as well. As always, we are on Instagram at Happy No Fear, and I'm at The Art of Chase. See you next week. Bye-bye.